Midway through our life's journey I came to, in the midst of a dark and dangerous wood, the way through, the straight path, the way to choose, having been lost, misplaced and erased from view. How hard it is here to even come near to describing sincerely and clearly the sheer horridness of this forest, such gruesomeness fierce that its merest mention renews all my fears. So bitter and awful, death is little more. But in order to talk of the good that would befall, I am forced to discourse, recall and share all of the myriad other things that I saw there. I am not aware, nor can easily describe the sequence of time that led me to arrive, stumbling tired in a wasteland and through dark, so full of slumber when I had abandoned the true path. But at last, after I had looked for it still, I found myself standing at the foot of a hill, at the end of that valley which had pierced my heart and blinded my mind with fear from the start. Gazing from the dark up the slopes and boulders, I was able to glimpse that mountain's shoulders, already clothed in the dawn light of the sun, which shows the way for the wanderer and guides everyone. Thus was the fear that had become so violent becalmed and made somewhat quiet. Fear had remained in the lake of my heart, the dweller, for that entire night which I had passed in terror. And like a swimmer with shortness of breath, who crawls onto the shore having avoided his death, and looks back at the scene and beholds the turmoil and boil of the sea as it rolls. Thus my poor soul, still hooked in panic, turned around and fearfully looked back at the passage, that valley, that ill fen, which had never left a person alive until then. I needed a moment to rest my weary bones, but then began scrambling over the stones, now to climb the barren slope, leaving ground behind, always keeping my stronger foot on the downside. Intrepid, but barely had I commenced this effort, then leapt out of nowhere a leopard, svelte and light, moving as a rapid blur, darting, cloaked in a pelt of dappled fur. I was disturbed, shepherded by this leopard, which didn't flee and impeded whichever way I was headed. Indeed, so confined I, unable to run, was tempted to turn and return the way I had come. Nevertheless, this was the hour of the morning. The sun was mounting in the shroud of the dawn, and alongside, the spring stars were rising above, just as on that auspicious day when the divine love first conspired to set into motion the beautiful events which inspire eternal devotion. So that there was reason for hopeful feelings, the glittering of that creature's coat even, and between the hour of the day and the sweet season, these all were causes for my easier breathing. Yet not so easy that fear could be defied when faced with the appearance of the face of a fearsome lion, seemingly charging on and towards me, teeth bared, with ravenous head held lofty, so that this ferocious beast there entering seemed to set in dread the very air trembling. I was tempted to escape, and I would have, but straight away came a slavering, emaciated wolf, a she-wolf with ribs exposed, whose savage hungering has caused so many casualties of lack and suffering, pummeling my spirit at the very sight of this creature, increasing my terror and fright. I reached the limit of my will to fight, and lost hope of crossing the slope and ascending the height. And like one who has had life handed to him on a plate, and acquired a fortune while things were great, who all of a sudden loses it all in a twist of fate, and breaks down weeping in a despondent state, thus I became when that remorseless beast, which knows no joy or thoughts of peace, approached without ceasing, snapping, growling and snarling, and forced me back down into the dark again. As I scrambled down the valley slope in retreat, hope defeated, suddenly I approached within reach of a figure who stood frozen speechless, as if he had spent eons with no speaking. When I could see him in that vast desert, I beseeched him, speaking to him, asking, begging, have mercy on me, I started to yell and demand, whichever you are, spirit or genuine man. He answered, I am not a man, not anymore, I already was a man, and my parents each hailed from the city of Mantua in the region of Lombardy. I was born to these late during the period of the reign of Julius Caesar, and lived in Rome under good Augustus in the time of the lying gods of false substance. I was a poet, and I composed and recited odes to that righteous son of Anchises, Aeneas, who fled from the city of Troy, splendid Ilion, as it was stripped and destroyed in fire. But tell me, why are you returning down here to the mire? Why are you not climbing higher on that mountain, the prime source of all that inspires? Could it be that you are that Virgil, that bounteous fountain of words that stirs still my heart and imparts such a river of speech? I responded to him thus, with a face hidden timidly, oh, I call upon from the honor and luminosity of all poets to now illumine the curiosity and draw up that long study, the depth of affection that allowed me to explore your epic collections. You are my master and you are my author, you alone among all poets with a single source of the beautiful style which has enveloped every single work I've had the honor to develop. See this terrible she-wolf beast on the slope that has made me turn back and defeated my hope. Please can you protect me, your legendary sage, for she makes the very blood tremble in my veins. For you the best way through is to take an entirely different route, he was moved to say when he observed the tears on my face. If you wish to escape from this fearful place, for this beast you face which sets your terror free, never permit anyone to cross her territory. And if someone attempts, she harasses his step so persistently that he is dragged to his death. And the savagery that she possesses of nature, so malign and ruthless, so desperate with hatred, with an appetite that could never be sated, but is hungrier after food than before she ate it. And she mates with anyone she can find, to uncountable animals as she offered her hind. And this number will continue to climb until the greyhound arrives to kill her in kind. This greyhound shall be one who feeds not on land or precious metals or on greed, but on wisdom, on love, and on good deed. His simple kingdom shall be vast and without need. Indeed, it is safe to say that it is he, the awaited savior of poor Italy, the country for whose sake Camilla the maid, Euryalus, Turnus, and Nisus were all slain. The she-wolf shall be ceaselessly chased by the greyhound through every single city-state, until he has eventually driven her down again to the inferno from whence she in envy came. Due to this beast, for your sake I advise that you should follow me and make me your guide. Stay by my side, I shall discern and trace a path through the maze of an eternal place, a place wherein you will hear desperate screams, wailing and moans, and you will see ancient spirits in pain, bereft of breath, each one crying out for the second death. Then you shall see those who, though located in the flames of the fire, remain contented, for they can harbor hope one day to enter, whenever it shall be, among the blessed. And then at that point, if you wish to ascend to see those people, a spirit will be sent who is more worthy than I can compare. Then I will depart and leave you with her there, because that all-powerful emperor that is the ruler up in heaven forbids anyone with me to travel through his city walls, given that I was rebellious to his laws. He rules over all and everywhere the same, and that is the place from which he reigns. That is his city and his most potent throne. How happy are those who were chosen to go. And so I said to him, poet, I beg of you, in the name of that same God you never knew, so that I may be allowed to flee this curse and escape the woe surrounding me and worse, please guide me and take me to the places you stated, so I may see the gates of Saint Peter and those pitiable ones you described. Then he moved off and I followed behind.